Welcome back to Sparks of Joy Studio. I'm Natalie, and we are going to jump right in to some scrap wood and just plain scrap projects. Let's get started. I have this piece of wood. This is a 2x8, I'm almost positive. And my husband cut it down for me, I believe, we're going to find out in a second, 18 inches long. It's about 18 inches long. We're going to turn this piece of scrap wood into a riser. I created these 4 feet using some scraps that I had in my stash, and we're going to be using some wood glue to glue them onto the base of this scrap wood. What I do want to mention is that I typically will glue my parts together when I'm doing a riser before I paint, because it does adhere better and has more durability in the long run. It makes it a little harder to paint, right? Especially if you want to do two tones or, you know, alter the colors in any way, make the feet different than the riser itself. But honestly, when you know that it's going to be a more quality piece, you kind of opt for this option. I am using Tight Bond wood glue, and I am going to clamp it together and allow it to sit overnight. Once it was fully dry and ready to be painted, I did paint it with a white paint. This is just serving as my base for decoupage. I'm going to be taking this Roycycle decoupage paper that I got from Sammy at Unicorn Dust Designs, and I'm going to be using liquid patina to adhere it onto the top and the front and back of this riser. I am not going to be decoupaging the ends of this. I really just want it to look like a sheet of almost like newspaper. I don't know. I want the style to be just the front over the top onto the other side. The other thing I want to mention, I'm not sure if you noticed, but on the left-hand side of this riser, I had originally painted these two lines. Basically what I did was I stained the entire riser in a gray stain. Then I put some painter's tape down and painted it white to create this these two stripes. I ended up not liking that look, which is why now I'm coming in with decoupage, but I wanted to see how it would look if I left those two dark spots there and had it come through on the decoupage paper. Also, because this piece of wood had a little bit more of a curved surface, I chose to keep the decoupage paper together and wrap it around the front and the back of the wood rather than cutting it and decoupaging it on in separate pieces, if that makes sense. I thought it would look a little bit more even. It wouldn't be as obvious where those lines would be. If this was a much more like clear edge where it was a little bit more sharp, I don't think it would have been as much of a concern to me, but this just felt like the best option for this piece. Here's a look at how those stripes came through on the top and around the sides. I think it looks amazing. And this is our finished project. It is painted on the base, like the little feet, and then underneath in raw silk by Fusion. For our next project, I have this 2x6 piece of wood. I got this lumber from Home Depot. What I do want to mention is a lot of the lumber measurements that you'll see, the actual piece ends up being slightly shorter than what it advertises, I guess. So this is actually measures to about 1¾ inches thick, and it's about 5¾ inches wide. So that's why it doesn't look like a perfect square. It is actually 6 inches tall because we cut that. I originally painted it with raw silk on the bottom part. No, not raw silk. I'm sorry. It is plaster by Fusion. I let that dry, and now I'm using Farm Fresh by DIY on top of that. Once the first coat was dry, I came back with a second coat of the Farm Fresh, and while it is still wet, I'm going to be taking this paint inlay that you see in view, and I'm going to be using it all around this piece of scrap wood. I do want to tell you that this is actually the second time I will be using this inlay. So I do not have the first project in today's video. It is not done yet, but this will be the second time. And another fun fact, the first time I used it, I had White Swan down on my project, and now I'll have the Farm Fresh. So it'll be interesting to see the way the colors come together. Typically, you would want to use the same paint when you're using a paint inlay more than one time, because some of that paint will end up on your paper transfer. However, I did see that Julie from Julie's Designs and Signs recently did a project where she used her paint inlay multiple times with different types of chalk paint for each of the instances she used it, and it came out really cool. So I want to try something similar and see how it goes. I set aside my project to dry for about 30 to 45 minutes until you see it kind of whitish on the top. And now I'm spraying it with a mister and slowly peeling back the paint inlay. And you will see that this is, like, again, this is the second time this paint inlay has been used, and it still has a very cool effect. It definitely is lighter and a little bit more distressed than the first time around, but you can still get the vibe of all those gorgeous colors that were in those roses. And here's a close-up of that paint inlay with that white swan kind of sprinkled in. Originally, I was going to make this into one of those scrapwood pumpkins, and I was going to use this chess piece as the top, that like stem of the pumpkin, but I ended up changing my mind as I was working on this. I decided to use some lace, and this lace is a little bit more elastic, and tie it on in a crisscross pattern so that on the front you'd be able to use it to kind of hold like a picture or a recipe card, I don't know, just something, some kind of ephemeral on the front. This is definitely a lot more shabby chic than what I typically would do, but I'm going with it. So after I have that adhered on, or not even adhered, I have it kind of just tied on. I didn't use any glue or anything. I wanted to find a way to embellish it a little bit more with this greenery and these roses. I added this lace, which I actually pulled off of a strip of ribbon that I had gotten from Dollar Tree. It's a pretty common one. It has the burlap and then this over it. Well, I was able to rip the two pieces apart pretty easily, and I'm tying that on an angle, or I'm sorry, off center. I'm tying it off center to the left, and then tying on that greenery. Again, I'm really trying to avoid using any glue because I want this to be something that could be versatile for the person who gets it. I'm not sure if you can tell, but I ended up having to untie and retie the pieces of lace so that the elastic one was over the lace that is holding the roses at the top. And I told you that the last project had time two that I was using a paint inlay. This is the third time using the same paint inlay, and it is on a smaller piece of wood. I don't know the measurements. It was just a scrap that I had in my stash with four little cubes at the bottom. So it's kind of like a mini riser or a raised coaster. I don't know, however you want to think of it. I painted it with the raw silk first, and then I have some apothecary that I put on. I kind of did a little bit more of a watery coat, so it's a little bit watered down. I don't really know the look I was going for. I just wanted to try something different, and as you can see, I'm using a third color. So the three colors I used, the White Swan, the Farm Fresh, the Apothecary, are all pretty cohesive, right? They can kind of go together, but they do offer different effects when using a paint inlay. So it was cool to see what it did. I guess I must have not recorded myself. Maybe I decided that you guys have seen enough of me pulling the paint lily off, but that is the most satisfying part. I'm kind of sad I didn't get that. Anyway, I have this stamp. This is the new stamp set. I think it's ephemeral type stamp. I'm not sure, but I'll leave it in the description box. And I'm using a Stazon ink color Timber. It's like a dark brown color. I didn't want to use black. I didn't want to use gray. So I'm trying this one out and it worked out really nicely. You could see how it takes on that effect. I love the stamp set because of the variety. And I love that I can just go in and not only lay it down on top of my project, but in this case with the sides of this piece, I just went and laid the piece right on top of the stamp with it turned upside down, obviously, so that it could create the sides. I could stamp on the sides without having to maneuver it staying up, not knocking over, and not having anything wobble, which would create some smudges in my stamp. I took these outside to spray seal it, and as you can see, I sprayed the other project we just finished as well. I just didn't want to show this clip yet because it would have ruined this surprise, right? So I am spraying it very lightly to seal in the paint inlay, the paint, and then also, which you don't necessarily have to do, but also to seal in the ink. For our next project, I have this wooden bin that I think I got it off Amazon, but I believe it's from Michaels. I have already painted the entire outside in a white paint, and I'm gonna be using this decoupage paper on it. I will link the name of this decoupage paper below because I do not remember the name of it. I love the bird, but I'm not gonna be using the bird for today's project. I am going to try to find pieces of this paper that are a little bit less not less detailed. I don't want to have the big flower or the big bird on them. I want to use the parts of it that just have the text and some of the abstract elements in it. So the inside of the box, I'm going to be painting in the color Skeleton Key by DIY. Now I'm going to be prepping the sides of the box for decoupage. They are already painted white, and I'm taking my liquid patina and I am going to decoupage the strips of paper that I cut out from that paper onto just the longer sides of this box. As always, I set it aside to dry, then sanded off the edges. And on the sides of the box that I did not decoupage, they are painted with Apothecary by DIY. And now I am taking this new stamp. I can't remember the name. I think it's Garden Bloom, but I'm not sure. I will find out. And it will be linked below. I'm stamping either side of it with those hydrangeas in IOD's Stone Gray. And for the last step, I have these handles that have been in my stash. They came off of another project that I had done a while ago, well before I started my YouTube channel. And I am going to be screwing them on to either side of this box. And of course, I forgot to film it and didn't tell you, but I did seal everything with a polyacrylic sealer. I used Big Top by DIY, and here is a look at our finished project. I really love the colors. I'm kind of impressed how well they blended. Apothecary and Skeleton Key, not necessarily colors I would put together, but I think it looks great. And here's an example of how you could style it up in a bathroom with a little trinket dish and some greenery and some hand towels. Our last project today is actually the only one not done with wood. This is actually a book. I have picked up so many hardcover books since I began thrifting and crafting. I even had a huge box of books donated to me back, I would say about 6 months ago, and I have yet to do a book project on my channel. So this is my first stab at it. I have this hardcover book that I painted in white, and now I'm gonna be decoupaging this paper. It is called Damask, I believe, and this is probably the first piece of decoupage paper that is not recycled that you've seen me do. I don't know that I've done any other kinds, but this I believe is JRV. I got this off of Upcycled by Brie. And usually you will find Brie over on Whatnot, not necessarily as much on YouTube nowadays. So I'm gonna link her Whatnot channel as well as her link in YouTube. This paper applies very similarly to the Roycycle decoupage paper, so it was pretty easy to mold into this material. I am spraying it down very lightly with some water, and then I'm going to be using my liquid patina and just creating that starter strip and slowly and carefully putting the pieces of, or decoupaging this paper on, being very mindful of the wrinkles. With this paper, I will say that because there's not as many embellishments and details, it is a much more two-toned type of paper with a lot of white peeping through. It's gonna be a lot easier to see the wrinkles. And where that did not work in my favor is that I was decoupaging onto a book that has just natural divots in it, right where that spine is, as well as some of the lettering that was on the cover of the book, which I tried to mask as much as possible. It's not perfect, but again, this is my very first time trying this, so I was pretty happy with how it turned out. As I did with the other project a little earlier in this video, I am trying to keep my paper all together rather than splitting it up into multiple pieces. I just feel like that looks a little bit more finished, and I was actually really impressed that even with a project like this where you would open and close the book, I did not have any rips or tears once I tried to mold it or manipulate it after I decoupaged. Now I'm going to be taking some air dry clay and one of the trimmings molds by IOD, and I'm going to be kind of creating a sausage shape or a snake shape with my clay and pressing it into this mold. I am really working into the details and then using the rim that's on the side to wipe off the excess clay. I flipped the mold over to pull that casting out of the mold, and I am not going to be letting it dry before I glue it onto my piece. I find that it is a little easier to manipulate and is not as breakable as it would be if you try to let it dry first. So I take some Tight Bond Quick and Thick, and I am spraying it all across the back of this trimming, and I am using I'm using a paintbrush to kind of spread it all the way to the edges. I want to make sure that that glue is across the entire casting so that it does adhere very well to this decoupage paper, which has been sealed, but still, I didn't know how it was going to turn out. Once I had it laid down with the glue, I did have to peel off a little piece that hung over the edge, which you see me doing right here, very carefully just tearing off that piece so that it looked a little bit more uniform on the top and bottom of my book. Typically, I would be painting this before it was dry, but I actually did set it aside to dry overnight. I wanted to make sure that I wasn't messing with the entire book too much while that decoupage paper was maybe not necessarily thoroughly dry. I don't know. I wasn't ready yet, I guess, for the next step. So I'm taking a pointed brush, a tapered brush, and I'm going to be using Laurentian by Fusion to paint just the casting that we put on the binding of this book. And since I definitely felt very out of my wheelhouse with all the projects today, because I'm not a very shabby chic person, I'm definitely trying a lot of new things here, I decided to try one of the new foil transfers in the most recent IOD release, which just happened about, what, a week ago? I will say Sammy got me my stuff super fast. I was so excited. I am going to be taking this piece of that transfer and transferring it onto this book. Now, as I had seen other creators use this on YouTube, I did notice that everybody seemed to say it was very much like the transfers, which I do agree. It does transfer on similarly to how the transfers would. It is just as easy. I will say I tend to have a heavier hand when I am using transfers, and I definitely had to be mindful of being a little bit more delicate with this, only because I noticed that when I rubbed a little harder, I was actually rubbing off some of the excess gold that was around the outside of the actual foil design. It didn't happen on this piece. I have another piece that I did, which I will possibly show in a future video. And I noticed that in that one, I was definitely a little bit too harsh with how I was transferring it on. So it's a learning process. I got this on the front, again, just to kind of see what it would look like with some gold embellishments. I also added some gold gilding wax by DIY onto the raised edges of that casting to allow some of the, details to come through. Again, gold is not really a color that I use very often. It's not something I have as part of my decor, but I wanted to really step outside my comfort zone, and I absolutely did with this project. Thank you so very much for joining me today. I hope you have a wonderful day. Please let me know if there was a specific style or a specific project that you liked best. And I look forward to seeing you again next time for more thrift flips and DIYs.